We have our next speaker in the audience. Our next speaker, in a manner of speaking, was all born into the law. He has been actively associated with the legal aid movement and has conducted several programs at various places in Mumbai. He is also actively associated with the Project Empowerment Through Law, a project aimed at empowering adolescent boys and girls of Mumbai by informing them about various aspects of law with view to making them better citizens of tomorrow. The Justice has also been a member of the Board of Studies on Law, University of Mumbai. He was a member of the Disciplinary Committee of the Bar Council of Maharashtra and Goa and was member of the Managing Committee of the High Court Library for the past several years. His subject today is very, very relevant in our times, and it is on business ethics. I would request all the members to please rise as the Justice is in the court and give him a warm round of applause. We present to you Justice Dharmadhikari.
The organizers of this day-long, possibly going over the evening event, namely the printers and packagers, I do not know why I am chosen to speak to you. I do not fit in any description. But when the organizers met and requested me to speak something related to law and ethics, and thereafter told me that the function is on a Friday evening, you would understand my reluctance. From Monday to Friday, it is nothing but law. Law and lawyers and litigants and books and everything to do with law. Friday evening back home, after nearly 6 and more hours of grinding work, from Monday to Friday, I think of everything except law. I want to do something with music, something to do with art, something to do with literature, and whatever other hobbies possibly a man like me might like to pursue. But since I was told that I am amongst printers, I thought I am near books, and I thought I am near books unrelated to law as well. I don't know how many of you print law books. None of you, maybe, possibly. But those of whom who print them need not be told what ethics, law and morals mean. Friends, when I was searching for something, some material rather, to speak to all of you, and I thought that since it has to do with business ethics, I thought let me first familiarize myself with what all of you are doing. the brochure that was given to me and which introduced me to the event. Contained several references to great personalities and luminaries who have come and spoken to you or have been in your midst. And I continue to be nervous because I think I would disappoint you. I do not belong to all that has been said about me. One of the organizing team persons said that they had heard my father speak some time back. Friends, judges of my father's gender had more time than us. At that time, people were not troubling them with all sorts of issues and problems. Leave alone problems of administration and governance. Now it is extremely difficult for a judge to find time and to speak at a gathering. Secondly, we are at such a time now that most judges would feel that they better not be seen. The reasons that make you smile and laugh are different than mine. There is certain code that we follow. Judges are not supposed to be seen, but are supposed to be read. Chief Justice S.P. Bharucha, his lordship was the Chief Justice of India, and earlier a very distinguished judge of this court, used to always say that judges should not be heard, but read. Nowadays, possibly in every event, people are short of guests, chief guests, presidents. So judges also have to be roped in. That possibly also attracts some judges, and they also feel that they have a personality and which ought to be seen. I do not have any such ideas about myself, but I wish to share a few thoughts with you. Friends, is there a place for ethics, morals, rules, regulations, and laws? And if it is in business, whether they are an obstacle, they are a hurdle, they present innumerable difficulties for smooth and proper functioning of business activity. For that, as I have always a very bad habit, I try and find out what actually the activity is. But I am not familiar with your technology. Being a layman in that sense, I search for the meaning of the word. My grandfather used to always tell us that if you want to turn to the dictionary for the meaning of the term, the dictionary would not provide one. The dictionary would give you at best an alternate word. The meaning of the word has to be searched and looked for in your life. What does it mean when you print something? And when I was looking at the dictionary today, I found that the dictionary says something which is very fascinating. It means produce books, newspapers, etc., by a mechanical process. But what it next says is very important. Fix firmly or indelibly in someone's mind. What you print goes to somebody's mind. It gets firmly fixed there. That possibly is your first lesson, and to follow some ethics and morals. Is there, therefore, a need to be ethical and moral when it comes to your own business activities or every business activity? For that matter, every activity. When you pack something, the dictionary tells you it means cover, surround, packages, filling or wrapping. Would you cover yourself something with something which exposes you to risk, which exposes you to some sort of an action by your own peers and equally by the state? I am sure none of you would like to be so exposed. Then why do we shudder law? Why do we fear all this? We fear it for a simple reason, because we don't know what is law. The first lesson, therefore, must be learned, and to find out why there is a law. Friends, law comes in because you do something which is not right, just or fair. You visit somebody's house, you find the house is locked, you go to a neighbor and inquire, that gentleman tells you about his whereabouts and tells you or informs you that he's out of town or he's temporarily gone out, and you return back. Thereafter, you either call up or you send a chit or a letter to that gentleman. Law is not necessary for such people, because the conduct is throughout right. Law is required when you break this. Law is when you try and barge into the house, even though knowing it is locked, knowing fully well that you have no authority to barge in when it is closed. This is the conduct which is brought in within the purview of law. But what is now our habit and possibly second nature is, unless and until this is written or it forms part of a written code, there is no need to follow it. Why should I follow law? For if there is nothing in writing, and if there is something in writing, if I breach or violate it, there is no penalty for it. There is no fine or punishment for it, goes the thought process. It is that which, friends, you must seriously think about. Would you therefore really insist on there being a written code for your conduct to regulate your activity, and which may penalize you for any wrongdoing? Or would you imbibe a principle in yourself? Or would you imbibe something in yourself so deep that would not require a regulation by law or by a written code? We all have a code for ourselves. I am sure, just as there is a code of professional ethics for advocates, for doctors, for all other professionals, equally in business, you have a code there are certain codes which you evolve, you circulate, and you thereafter follow. The increasing tendency is not to have this voluntary prescription being followed. Even if it is applied, I am not bound to follow it. That is how the thought process goes. That is how one acts. Therefore, one needs to know what are your ethics. If ethics mean the moral principles governing or influencing your conduct, if morality means what is right and wrong, based on or adhering to the code of behavior that is considered socially right or acceptable, principles of right and wrong, then definitely there are some professional ethics. There is a professional code. And each one of you possibly is aware of it. However, now the insistence being, and possibly in my generation or a generation thereafter, you give me something in black and white, sir. This is how the talk goes, possibly, and you are aware of it. Is there anything in black and white? I do not know how a person who is already black can insist on black and white. If you want to be white, you must admit that there is something black. And thereafter, how to make it white, possibly you may find some solution. But when you are insisting for a written rule or a written regulation, then you are in serious difficulties. You have, and by your conduct, and when I say you means all of us, we have brought a regime where the state had to intervene. There were times when we would go by an unwritten code. And in your language, known to you, very friendly language, unprinted code, uncirculated code, unwrapped code. Everybody was bound. No morals were ever written, except that I remember in my school days having a subject, moral science. However, now when we insist on this, friends, what is the scenario? The scenario is we have gone away from all this, and what was taught, what was imbibed by our teachers, by our forefathers, ancestors. And once you depart from that, you have to be brought on the straight line, on the right path. Then that becomes the duty of the state. There is an insistence that what is wrong if I walk in the middle of the road? But you are not supposed to walk. You may get hit by a vehicle. A vehicle may hit you, a vehicle may kill you. But then that vehicle wala should bother, no? He should honk. He should slow down and ensure that I am away from his path. If that is how we are conducting ourselves in every sphere of life, then it is unfortunate that we invite the state to make a law. And then we only complain. This is a country where there are too many laws. Very often when I go for even legal seminars, I am asked, how many laws, sir, in this country? And when are we going to stop? And where? I said, you are asking the wrong question, because you must ask the right question. The right question is when I am going to stop my behavior, which is contrary to law. If for everything you require a written code or a written law, and the state makes it, then you would want the state to make a provision in that so as to make that law inapplicable, and that it should not harm, that it should not hurt an innocent. The state would then sit down, the parliament would then sit down to make a law and would say something which is merely irregular but not illegal would not be punishable, meaning thereby something which is curable, remediable, remedied, capable of being remedied, you would not require to be punished. Then what happens? Everybody says, my conduct is merely irregular, it is curable, therefore provide for this exception. Then the exception overtakes the rule, and we have to search for the rule. The life is, friends, complex, complicated. We have contradictions in our life. So long as we lead such a life, our laws are bound to be worded and accordingly. We want everybody's dream aspiration to be taken care of while making a law. It should be perfect. That is our next insistence. First, you must have a written law. Secondly, it must be perfect. I will be as imperfect as possible, but the law must be perfect. This insistence comes from whom? Citizens. Citizens who enjoy a fundamental freedom according to them to carry on any trade, business or profession of their choice. When they say this, and when we talk of the constitutional mandate and freedom, we forget that the Constitution equally says that this freedom is subject to a reasonable restriction. Subject to a reasonable restriction in the interest of general public. Not in your interest and mine, but the general public. Therefore, the restrictions come in. The restrictions are reasonable. You ought to challenge them. As restrictions, the state must discharge its responsibility to show that they are reasonable and in the interest of general public. But you must have noticed that plethora of laws are there which are challenged like this. But they have not been declared as invalid or illegal by the court of law, simply because their object and purpose has been understood. Their meaning has been explained in the context in which I have spoken to you. My few prefatory words, therefore, friends, explain the need, the object and purpose of every legislation. Now, why multiple legislation? Just see the next insistence that comes. The reasonable restrictions should not come like this. They must be defined. Once they must be defined, then they must also form part of a law. That law must be valid. That law must equally be made by a competent legislature. Only then there is a mandate to follow that law. Then the next step comes where the court considers all this and says, sorry, this is a reasonable restriction. You have not understood it. And why, when we say that every reasonable restriction has to be defined and has to form part of a separate law, is the answer to the first thing about the plethora of laws. Multiple legislation, which is not very healthy according to all of you. So many gatherings like this, the speaker is usually asked the same question. Kindly tell us, how do we carry on business with so many laws? We have to comply with so many laws, follow so many rules and regulations in those laws. Eventually, we must carry on business or we must close it down. Is it really a genuine and honest difficulty? Is a question which you must ask yourself. Law doesn't create a problem for you. You create a problem for everybody, therefore the law comes. Just see the title of the laws that I'll give you as an illustration. Consumer Protection Act 1986 came. Why? Because in the two important players or stakeholders, as is the today's world, the consumer was always forgotten. You know that, no? Where a preacher comes and writes, I preach for all, or I pray for all. Lawyer writes, I plead for all. A common man is also part of the gathering. He says, can I raise my hand? I also want to write something. He writes, I pay for all. That was the gentleman who was out of the scheme altogether. No interest of the consumer was ever taken into consideration until an organization as high as the United Nations had to step in. That required every country, member country, to make a regulation or a rule or a law to protect the interests of the consumers. And to protect the consumers from what? Unfair trade practices. One of the protection. Unfair trade practices. Our own conduct brought this regime. If the conduct was fair, the trade was clean, we were on the right side, unfair trade practice should not have been finding place at all. One of the earliest laws was Monopolies and Restrictive Trade Practices Act. The definition was properly and clearly demarcated between unfair trade practice and a restrictive trade practice. Monopoly is an anathema. We avoid competition. We detest it. What happened was, somebody complained and said, whether it is restrictive, whether it is unfair, monopoly is monopoly. Treat monopoly in a different way. Take it as a part of an anathema or an opposition to competition at large. Therefore came the Competition Act, replacing the Monopolies and Restrictive Trade Practices Act. As if that was not enough, those dealing with food and food items and trading in them, for them the prevention of food adulteration came, but now the Food Safety Act. As if all this was not enough, those prescribing and to what rules and regulations, something to do with packaging, something to do with standards and weights and measures, that all came under the scheme of the Legal Metrology Act now. All this has come because of us. And instead of questioning the wisdom of the parliament, instead of blaming the people for demanding the legislation, my only request to all of you is throughout the day find some time to ponder and ask yourselves, why were these laws brought in at all? Why were they brought in? Because was I printing something and circulating something which should not have been circulated? There are women in the crowd and they will also realize that I am not unfair to them. There are certain legislations brought in specifically to ensure that when you advertise, when you sell something, you don't resort to a representation of women which is indecent. And all this flows because we forget that with every right, there is a corresponding duty. There is nothing like an absolute right. There is nothing like an vested right. There is a right to carry on business, trade and profession. Rather, it is your fundamental right and freedom. But there is equally a restriction, and which can be placed on it if you cross the limits of reasonableness, do something which is prohibited. And that is why all laws have been brought in so as not to take away your right, but to make it meaningful. Where do you find this? You would find an answer to all this in the Constitution itself, in a chapter related to fundamental duties of citizens. That fundamental duty, which is an article brought in by the constitutional amendment, tells you that you must excel in your individual sphere of activity, and to such an extent that by your performance you elevate the nation as a whole. You take the nation to greater heights. Your achievements are not your individual achievements. This is where the understanding must come. Just as everything that vests in the state and which is styled as a power, that power is coupled with a duty and responsibility, equally this right which is conferred in us and which we claim and which we cherish has a corresponding duty. That corresponding duty must be discharged. That we are not doing so is apparent and clear from the number of cases that are clogging the court and which involve a lot of businessmen. Is this sort of a gathering ever giving a thought to all this? Can we not avoid this? Can we not say that my fellow businessman or a fellow citizen or somebody who is a consumer should not drag me unnecessarily to the court? Of course, you have a right to defend something which is frivolous and vexatious. But the opportunity that you give on most of the occasions for people to go to court and against all of you, that could be minimized. That could be taken care of by your own code, by your self-regulation mechanism. There is something like a self-regulatory mechanism and which all of you possibly have evolved. The question is of implementing and following it. Why I ask this question? Because everywhere there is a general and irresponsible complaint that, sir, there are too many laws but there is no implementation. That question can be posed to you as well. All professionals for that matter. All businessmen for that matter. Why is this question not asked in our own gatherings? Where are we lacking? Why is that search not beginning? And if it is begun, it is not taken to its logical end. This search, and it is necessary, friends, for the generations who are now coming in business. There are business houses. There are old business houses. There are established business houses. And there are youngsters and the new generation coming. Before they ask questions, and inconvenient to all of you, you must give them the answers. If they don't want to do business unfairly, don't tell them ever that don't follow the law. If that is how the advice will go, and see how I have avoided law and I have never got caught in the web of law, And with that supreme confidence, if you move around, the wrong signal is sent to this generation. And when then this generation gets into a real cobweb, you have no solutions for them. The business has become competitive. The business is expanding. Now, from 1992 onwards, we talk of globalization, liberalization, privatization. These are key words, no? And our father of the nation used to tell us, you should always think globally, but act locally. Our global thought has never come. Our local maturity is never shown. All these words therefore carry no meaning. But the coming generation has found that there are meanings, and real meanings and practical meanings to these words. They have to face tough competition, tough days. And when they competition is not just with local people, but at international level, they will know the importance of all this. It is necessary, therefore, to inculcate it, and from inception, from the time they enter the business sphere, they must be told that you cannot avoid a competition. You cannot sell something which is not packed in a standard, which is not in accordance with the measure or weight prescribed by law. And if it is exceeding, you must have multiple packages or safe packages. You can't print something and sell it, even if you are getting money and tons of money, which would bring disrepute, disgrace to the nation in the form of insult to somebody, an indecent presentation. If you refuse, you face no penalty. But you insist on publishing and printing that, you invite trouble for yourself. People say it is a work of art. People would say anything. But then, when the lawmaker makes a provision and the implementer of the law asks you to explain your conduct, you have to face the music, not all those who are sermonizing throughout day and night. Therefore, those who complain about such strict regime must be also equally blamed. I would blame my generation, post-independent generation, post-independence irresponsible generation, who never understood, or rather misunderstood and misapplied the meaning of the term independence. We never understood what is the difference between freedom and independence. Freedom was from a British regime, a foreign regime. Independence was an independence of thought, expression. Independence has a wider connotation, wider meaning. When we become truly independent, and we did, we never knew the worth of it. You have only to see your neighbors. We have only to see our neighboring countries and find out whether there is at all any protection for anybody by a properly made law in a democratic process and in a democratic manner. Here in India, we don't know the importance of all this, for it is our elected representatives who make law. The parliament makes laws, and the Supreme Court tells us it sits down to make laws because it is necessary to make law. It sits down to make a law because it understands the difficulties, problems. It understands the dreams and aspirations, and it tries to fulfill. It tries to give it meaning and place. And that is why it creates rights and duties and responsibilities. It doesn't sit there to make something which is unnecessary, or that it does something merely to pass time. Therefore, when a parliament makes the law, gives a right or power to somebody to implement it, take a few harsh decisions, we say, is this democracy? You must go to the neighboring countries and find out whether there is any rule of law. And on several occasions, the exhibition of that is seen by us. We have a media which covers everything and which we see in the comforts of our homes. In the luxuries and comforts of our office, we complain that law gives us no protection. Find out from your friends doing business abroad and in at least in our neighboring countries whether there is enough protection afforded to them. This, my endeavor is to tell you that please do not misunderstand this. This one-sided reading and one-sided interpretation gives you an impression as if law, lawyers, courts, judges are a hindrance. If we have to go and comply with all of this, it is impossible to do anything in life. That is normally heard and a very sweeping remark, don't you think all of? We must not go by such general, sweeping, vague complaints and assertions. Rather, the answers must be searched, and once they are available with ourselves. Friends, I do not wish to take more time for the simple reason that you have been listening and listening and listening whole day. Possibly you have been involved in too many debates and discussions. You would like to express yourselves some way or the other, and the rest of the evening is reserved for that. I think if that is how you want to give a way to your feelings, your views and expressions, I do not wish to come in your way. I only tell you, as was requested, that the emphasis being on good conduct, morals, ethics, having understood all these words, having understood the meaning of the word professional. The word professional is not just competent, but I have also seen it being spoken as a person with sensitivity, sensible. He is not only expert, he is also a person who is aware of so many things. That awareness, and particularly about your social role and responsibility, is what makes you true professional. A loose word is often used as trader. And why is trading spoken in such loose terms? I detest that, and I also am critical of that. Is trading such a bad activity? Because no one reads the Constitution and the law, therefore they feel that it is something which must be taken from, torn from context. It has a specific place and it is given in the Article 19(1)(g) of the Constitution, which talks of freedom of trade, business, occupation, profession. These are four words used and differently. Not because at that time there was a struggle to find out what is to be inserted. So the dictionary was lying, some word was picked up and inserted. That freedom is to do every such activity as would fall within a trade, business, occupation and profession. But all such activities being subject to reasonable restriction. Do not ask these questions that where is the need to be moral and ethical. That requirement is inbuilt in this constitutional article, because the reasonable restriction itself is founded on this. What should not be indecent should not be presented. What should not be presented is something which is indecent. If your presentation is indecent, then where does the word come from? Not from the dictionary, except from the law. If something is immoral and unethical, the word morality also comes in from the constitution. Because no one reads the constitution and the law, therefore they feel that it is something which must be taken from, torn from context. It has a specific place and it is given in the Article 19(1)(g) of the Constitution, which talks of freedom of trade, business, occupation, profession. These are four words used and differently. Not because at that time there was a struggle to find out what is to be inserted. So the dictionary was lying, some word was picked up and inserted. That freedom is to do every such activity as would fall within a trade, business, occupation and profession. But all such activities being subject to reasonable restriction, do not ask these questions that where is the need to be moral and ethical. That requirement is inbuilt in this constitutional article, because the reasonable restriction itself is founded on this. What should not be indecent should not be presented. What should not be presented is something which is indecent. If your presentation is indecent, then where does the word come from? Not from the dictionary, except from the law. If something is immoral and unethical, the word morality also comes in from the constitution. Therefore, law and morals are not divorced, as somebody may loosely tell you. Legislation would, as it said, morality is the center. Legislation is the circumference. That's how Bentham puts it. In what comes in that circumference is for you people who are experts in science, technology, and particularly the art of printing, packaging, would know better than me. Therefore, I end up, and when I am always tempted to end with something that sums up, and effectively we find that our literary figures, and particularly our poets, have given us enough. One of the poets says that tum besahara ho to kisi ka sahara ban, tumko apne aap hi sahara mil jayega. Kashti koi doobti hui bacha do, tumko apne aap hi kinara mil jayega. It is this self-regulatory mechanism where you help somebody who is distressed, and when you have that feeling in yourself, you would protect the interest of the consumers. When you want to take somebody to the destination, you would follow what the poet says and take somebody to his destination, and then you are not lost. Never feel lost because of the law. Law is not as that bad as is always portrayed. But law also is protective. Law also is emphatical. Law tells you and reminds you of your own ethics of your own code, of your own morals, and therefore there is nothing wrong if you are a friend of the law. Thank you, friends.
Thank you very much. Could I have Tushar Bhutika on the stage to give away the memento to the justice? The laws of our society are a reflection of our behavior. Lot to think about, lot to ponder on. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.